this might be as good as it gets. Shout out War Week Radio Network. You know, it's how they have the seating, of course. All three classes, 2020, 2021, 2022. So it's gonna be jam packed. But as close as it gets, y'all follow the Boxing Source, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and we'll have photos too from the weekend. See how things go, you know, but about as good as it gets. Might have some highlights from the parade, you know, earlier today. It's pretty quick. We were able to pull it off, so. But now we got this. Supposed to be scheduled to start in a few minutes. So we'll see how that goes. But just sit tight, y'all. Yeah, true. What you said, like Roy Jones and all them. So I talked with him, you know, while he was in the route, you know. He my guy, one of my guys, because he from, like you say, he Cola. He a Florida boy, and I'm a Florida boy. So we got that, you know what I'm saying? That's what we do, man. I'm Florida boy. Some flashes out here too, because let's be with the camera, but I might be roaming with the camera a little bit too, so y'all, so hopefully nobody moved the stand here. We're gonna make it work. Over under. Oh shoot. I ain't talked with the master of ceremonies. See what James Smith or Smitty was talking about. You know, the thing for the banquet, it was limited to like 5 or 7 minutes. And George Floyd with like what 15 minutes or so with his speech last night. So for Bernard, what it was, it's on the channel. The thing from last night is about 8 minutes. So I'd say over under for today is 12. 12 minutes. All right. So 12 minutes is over under for B-Hop. Let me see what I can do. So let's see how that goes. Good morning. I mean, hey, you got. I mean, the thing is, You got three classes, so we'll see how it go. Cheer this joint, y'all.
Bear with me, folks.
Well, I don't even know if he's here. I mean, I ain't see him in the parade, you know. He certainly was not here over the weekend, so yeah, I don't see him being here like that. So bear with me, y'all. Yeah, let's see how this goes, see how this works. Shit's hurting the fuck out of me, y'all. As you can see, this whole Zoom thing probably ain't gonna be all too hot, but we'll see. Big ups to all that have joined in. Yeah. Oh, no problem, man. No problem. You know, and we got a few people out here that we'll be capturing it. But thanks for, you know, joining in on this channel. You know what I mean? Hopefully on the Facebook page, Boxing Source Facebook page, I'll post photo highlights of the weekend. You know, good amount of either fighters, trainers, referees, you know, columnists or people covering, you know, requested photos. So, you know, Antonio Tarver, you know, Sean Porter, Masters Ceremonies, James Smith, Smitty, you know, Lou DiBella, Mauricio Suleiman, who else? Roy Jones a little bit. But outside of that, you'll see a few others, you know. So, let's see what we get, all right? Too long. You have a charger, mobile charger. Gotta get that. Lead is open, but I'll be right back. I can get all the photos.
Right.
It still ain't started yet. Like, we still. Oh, yeah. Kodo? Yeah, Kodo. Yeah, that's gonna be about 2.5 minutes.
Not three, 2.5 minutes.
2.5 minutes. Hold up, y'all. I forgot to do something. I'm gonna do it right now. I'm telling you, man, 2.5 minutes. Especially that. Look, you're talking about Miguel Cotto, right? He was just at Madison Square Garden last night. Went from there to go straight here, and then only a few minutes until he was in the parade. it's gonna be about 2.5 minutes. He gonna sleep.
It's for real.
Like, oh, tripping. Like, Marquez is gonna have a speech like at least twice as much, twice as long as that. So, you know how that gonna go. Y'all, I'm gonna see how this works. Not sure if you see, but Floyd Seniors just came in. I think he like walked Floyd Seniors there. At the banquet, at the end of the banquet, once James Smith or Smitty pretty much like officially concluded the end of the banquet, a whole rush of fans just started running to the tables to get autographs and all that stuff. So it was crazy. I thought it was gonna get trampled. But hold on, let me do something real quick. Oh, wait. Yeah, they did call out Roy for all that. They did have a little segment for Ladd at the banquet. It might have something today, but I'll reserve comment on that. All right, this internet joint ain't gonna work. I'm gonna see if I can rumble around, see what I get. You know, gonna have a number of notable people coming in and out through this thing. So let me see if I can do something real quick.
Take your seats.
My head is like right here. I'm making pics. Y'all do it.
the great location here for this year's induction ceremony and looking forward to all three classes being honored.
Let's go, Tony!
I'd like to now call on Joey Fiano to sing our national anthem.
Let's go, Joe.
In
Mauricio!
1892 and quickly captured featherweight title race. He captured the lightweight via 20-round decision against George Levine, and while away from the ring, he was boxing instructor at Yale University. He passed in 1954 at Beth David Hospital in New York City. Full-timer 2020, Frank Kern. Born in Tipperary, Ireland in 1853, he came to the U.S. with family at age 8 and settled in Troy, New York. As a teen, he found work as a lock tender under Gary Connell and took up boxing under Rensselaer Prophylactic Institute and the director was Jimmy Calder. He won the American heavyweight by stopping Joe Gaines in 84 rounds. Then he lost the time to John O'Sullivan in 9 rounds in 1882. 2020 was the Hardy Commission, Patty Ryan. Born in Lexington, Kentucky, raised in Springfield, Ohio, he compiled a 120-5 amateur record and represented the U.S. in the 1952 Helsinki Olympic Games. He lost the WBC WBA featherweight title to Sugar Ramos by 10-round stoppage and suffered a brain injury. When his head hit the bottom rope after the knockout, he died 3 days later. Known as the Springfield Rifle for his entire punch style all over the world, in 2013, the statue of him was erected in Springfield. 2001, Old John Cavalry, 81. Born in Oxnard, California, he followed his father into the ring, having met champions Manny Ortiz and Earl Day before retiring. He began managing and training fighters in 1953 and would become the Guardians one of the most respected figures in the sport. His first world champion was Don Jordan. He would go on to guide a stable of boxers such as Mando Ramos, Tony Carlos, Palomino, and Raul Rojas. 2001 non-participant Jackie McCoy. Born in Manhattan, he boxed as an amateur before a nose injury forced him to retire. He eventually retired from the shoot list to train professional boxers in 6 decades of career. He was renowned as one of the best in the sport. One of the boxers he worked with was Gaston Ortega, George Chaval, Alan Terrell, Dick Tiger, Floyd Patterson, and many more. He passed less than 4 months after receiving his Custom Honor Award for outstanding service in the field from the New York State Athletic Commission. 2021 non-participant, Freddie Brown. Born in Brooklyn, he graduated from C.W. Post, Long Island University, Boston Conservatory of Music, and UCLA School of Theater, Film, and Television. He began working at Showtime in 1984. Showtime became one of the most influential figures in boxing. The stars of that work showcased included Evander Holyfield, Mike Tyson, Julio Cesar Chavez, Felix Trinidad, and Ricky Yatton. In 2005, he, along with Rich Bernardo, was the recipient of the Boxing Ring of St. Tall Award for excellence in broadcasting. He passed away August 9, 2010, at the age of 59, from a brain tumor. 2021 Observer Category, Jay Larkin. Born in New York, playing in the Trailblazer era, he had an everlasting impact. Her impact on boxing was a successful mid-70s lawsuit against the powerful and influential New York State Athletic Commission. That allowed female boxers to be licensed to box professionally in the Empire State, thus paving the way for the next generation. She passed away with colon cancer in 2009 at the age of 75. 2021, Trailblazer Category, Jackie Caruana. Born in Grass Valley, California, he settled in Boston in 1970 to pursue a career in freelance writing. In 1972, he became sports editor of Boston Phoenix. In 1979, he was added to the Boston Herald as a sport columnist and remained there for 25 years. His start at the Herald proceeded to rise a marvelous Marvin Hagler middleweight title reign, and he drove Pete Weekly boxing columns. He would cover nearly 400 world title bouts before leaving the Herald, but continued to cover the sport for Irish Times, Sports Science, and ESPN. He authored books including The Four Kings, and he won the Boxing Writers Flight and Fletcher Award for Excellence. He died at age 67 following a lengthy battle with cancer. 2001 observer George Kimball. Born in Dennis, Washington, he turned pro at flyweight in 1920. As a contender at the 1930-pound junior lightweight title, he upset Mike Bellino to win the title and become the first world champion from Washington State. He reigned for 4 years, successfully defended the belt 12 times. After losing his title, he relocated in Australia and was extremely popular with fans down under. 1946, he returned to the United States and referred matches and worked as a bellboy before falling ill and passing away at age 50. 2023, old-time contemporary, Todd Morgan. Born in Jacksonville, Illinois in 1953, he was named the first sports writer class Channel B in Las Vegas. He began his ring announcing career the following year. His first championship fight was against Benny Kid Correct and John Jordan Bout. He worked all the title contests in Caesars Palace in Las Vegas until 1989. Some called from the center ring, Sugar Ray Leonard, Thomas Hearns, Marvin Hagler, Thomas Hearns, Larry Holmes, Harry Cooney, and Muhammad Ali and Larry Holmes. He retired in 1995 with over 130 world championship bouts to his credit. And that is the 2020 category, Chuck Hull. Okay, now we'd like to move on, and we are going to call on some of the relatives of these deceased. First, I'd like to call on Joan Steen, cousin of Jackie Palamon.
Of the Boxing Hall of Fame. I'm going to read what
what it says. Since there have been tens of thousands of people involved in this political professional boxing, only a few are memorialized for their achievements in the International Boxing Hall of Fame. Inductees at the International Boxing Hall of Fame in Taylor Store, New York, are determined by the criteria of the Hall of Fame and the vote of the Boxing Writers Association of America. Boxing writers and historians from throughout the world. Congratulations to the high regard in which you are held in this knowledgeable group. The honor symbolizes your accomplishments in the sport of boxing,
Flaky.
A worldwide renowned sport that requires discipline,
thank you. Thank
dedication,
thank you.
And talent for the success of your team. Each one of your students and the living darkness to get this plus. So now I'd like to call John Ryan, the great grandson from Danny Ryan.
Here at the Hall of Fame. If Freddie Brown was here today, He would have a big smile on his face, chewing on a cigar, and talking boxes with all these greats up here and out there. The only person he would also want to thank would be his greatest fan, his corner woman, his wife, and boxing enthusiast, Yurma Brown. Once again, thank you, everybody. God bless. Brooke Hashem.
Okay, up next, Peter Kimball, the brother of George.
On behalf of my brother George, thank the International Boxing Hall of Fame for this great honor. And I know that if George was here, he would be especially proud to be among this historic trilogy of inductees, including so many great writers, fighters, and champions. And he'd offer a special shout out to his fellow trilogy inductees, Lou DiBella, Thomas Hauser, and Ron Morris. Over the years, I was lucky enough to go with George to work, college, and professional sporting events that I could remember. World Series, NCAA Final Four, Orange Grove Sugar Bowls, 5 Super Bowls, and more Kentucky Derbies than I have fingers and toes. But I never fully understood George's complete love of boxing until he took me to Atlantic City to see a Taro Gatti fight next door. George is the first of 7 children. Today I'm here with our sister Becky, who is number 6 of 7. I am 5 of 7. Our mother, Sue, always taught school, and after the birth of her 7th child, Sue got her master's in communication. 12 years later, a PhD, and at the age of 57, she began a career teaching college for more than 20 years, until the university discovered she was 3 years past the mandatory retirement age. Mom was the only one who could beat George at Scrabble, and I know if George was here, he would thank her mother, Dr. Sue L. Kimball. One of the things that most people don't know about George is that for his entire life, he was a foot soldier in the battle for equality and justice for all. And his politics may have been the reason he got along so well with Muhammad Ali. Among our many favorite family treasures is a photo of a smiling Ali holding George's infant daughter, Darcy, and a few years later, another photo with the greatest holding his infant son, George IV. Darcy is a nurse in Colorado about to give birth to her first child literally any day now. And George IV is a hotshot firefighter in Arizona. Late last year, he became the proud father of George V. And if you knew George, then you know how important family was to him. And if he was here, he would want to thank his children, Darcy and George, their mother, Sarah, and his loving wife, Dr. Marge Marish. George and Marge were married in 2004, a ceremony presided over by the Reverend George Foreman I, who was also the father of George V, so it's a tie. When George was diagnosed with cancer in 2006, the odds were 50-50 and he'd be gone in a year. But if you ever played golf with George, then you know how competitive he was. He had the heart of a champion. In the 6 years he had left, he didn't fight cancer. As a legacy for his children, he published 6 books in 6 years, including The Fighter Still Remains, The Man in the Art, At the Fights, and The Four Kings. By all accounts, the definitive chronicle of the 9 fights between Marvelous Marvin Hagler, Sugar Ray Leonard, Thomas the Hitman Hearns, and Roberto Duran. Most unfortunately, a few years ago, after a series of meetings with Showtime, where the Four Kings was actively pitched as a series, Showtime moved the number 4 from the title to just a 4-part documentary based on George's work called The Kings, and failed to acknowledge George in any way. Again, thanks to the Boxing Hall of Fame for this great honor. And I know if George were here, he would proudly consider this the pinnacle of his 4-year career.
Thank you.
humbled to accept this honor on behalf of Jay. Our father Jay lived and breathed the sport of boxing. Whether in the office or at home, it was his obsession. In the years after his departure from Showtime Networks, he always closely followed goings on in the industry, kept in touch with colleagues, and offered guidance to those seeking it. As one of the men behind the creation of Showtime Championship Boxing and Showbox, his impact on bringing the sport of boxing onto television cannot be overstated. Behind the scenes, he also happened to be a perfect dad, a perfect nephew, perfect husband, and perfect son. We very deeply regret that he couldn't be here himself to accept this honor, and I can only imagine how truly unbelievably ecstatic he would be right now. Thank you so much to everyone here for including our father among such legends, past and present. Gabriel would like to make some remarks. Thank you again.
I'm more shy than my uncle was, so I'll keep it short and sweet. If you knew him, you'd know his greatest loves were God, family, boxing, and an audience for his jokes. He truly loved the sport and dedicated his life to it. I have many fond memories of summers in high school working at the office with my dad, my cousin Craig, and my uncle Dan. At the time, I was actually pretty mad at my mom living in New York, but looking back, I realized how lucky I was to be taught the ins and outs of the business from someone like him. We were all lucky to learn from him and be in his presence. He always encouraged me to work in boxing, even when I tried to rebel against the family trade. But for us Goosens, boxing is family. Boxing was our immediate family, starting with my grandpa, Elliot Goosen, and an empty lot in North Hollywood, California. We put on shows at the Country Club in Reseda where everyone was involved. My Uncle Joe, who I'm sure will soon be a Hall of Famer himself, right guys?
Yep.
My Uncle Larry, who had a gym in Big Bear, a training camp too. My Uncle Pat, who was a fighter himself, as were his three sons, Eric, BJ, and Chucky. My mom, Sandy, ran the ticket booth with her mom. And of course, my dad, Tom Graham, another future Hall of Famer. Matchmaking and master of the trade. Boxing was a immediate family, but it was also extended family. Looking out in the crowd today and all the inductees, I recognize so many people that my Uncle Dan loved and recognized as honorary nuisance. To know Uncle Dan, even as a competitor in boxing, was to share a state, a drink, and a laugh with him. The continued success of his clients and the recognition so many of them are receiving this weekend would have made him as proud as his own induction. So today my Uncle Dan enters the Hall of Fame, but with every big fight, every bombastic press conference, and even every loud suit someone wears, his legacy endures. On behalf of Goose's family, to our extended boxing family, cheers to 2020's International Boxing Hall of Fame inductee, Daniel A. Goosen.
I'm ready to recognize our inductees. And just to remind you, this is our trophy, which means we have three participants here. And each one of them will receive a ring from the Boxing Hall of Fame. And our certificate also. Now, as you know, too, at the 2020 Hall of Fame began recognizing female boxers, and we are so pleased to see the first three classes here. Not only Verona, but Castro. So congratulations. Now I'd like to call on Jim Lane Jr. for a few remarks.
But the spotlight is the key. That's why I work so hard to pronounce the fighters' names correctly. Try to interview them, make sure I get their nickname correct, their hometown, their records, their accolades, everything, because these fighters deserve that spotlight. I'm so proud to be inducted into the International Boxing Hall of Fame in 2013. I proudly wear this ring when I announce the fights. My purpose is to put it on my ring announcing hand so that everyone can see the possibility, because it's something that means so much to me. I'm also very proud to be one of the few father and son inductees into the International Boxing Hall of Fame. And of course, I think of the greatest thing about the Hall of Fame, and thank you for that recognition there for him. I want to tell you something, that at the peak of his career, where he had done so many huge fights, including about 75 television and movie appearances in boxing, the peak of his career, he one day was asked to participate in a film by an unknown actor who also wrote the film. His name was Sylvester Stallone. He reluctantly agreed to do the part in the role, not only because, I say, it was a minimum paid job and he was convinced by the casting director. He agreed to do it. The casting director said, just one thing, got to meet the director. Just want to introduce you to the director. So he went into the office of the director who was sitting down. And the director looked up and said, so you're the ring announcer. Dad said, yes, you don't look like a ring announcer. My dad said, well, you don't look like a director. You like the script. So that meant that he was never in Rocky One, but Sylvester Stallone invited him to be in Rocky Three, and he was very proud of that. Did he regret that? Yeah, absolutely, he regretted that. Hey, listen, on behalf of the alumni, we extend a very special welcome to the legends of the sport, both of the past, the present, and the future. A heartfelt thank you to the board, to the volunteers who do so much to make this successful, and to you, the fans, who have been so supportive year after year, and this year you just make the boxing world feel so very special. And congratulations to the inductees, the class of the International Boxing Hall of Fame 2020, 2021, and 2022, to my left and to my right. And with further ado, I will close with this, as it is time to shine boxing's brightest and most prestigious spotlight on the well-deserved inductees of the International Boxing Hall of Fame. And with this I say, and now, ladies and gentlemen in attendance and boxing fans joining us around the world, live from Turning Stone Resort Casino in the nearby home of the International Boxing Hall of Fame of Canastota, New York, it's showtime!
First, we have a little video I'd like to play on the screen. that she has sent us. Born in Amsterdam, Netherlands, a championship martial arts artist, she posted a 37-0 kickboxing record before pursuing a boxing career. In the following 8 years, she went undefeated, posting a 17-0 record. Soon after turning pro, she switched to trainer Freddie Roach and signed with Bob Arum's top rank. She captured the WIBF superweight title and the IBO superweight title. In 2005, she portrayed Billy the Blue Bear in the Academy Award winning motion picture The Dollar Lady. A proposed super fight with Christy Martin was canceled due to an Achilles tendon injury. She has remained in the sport as a trainer, guiding young Deanna Partzik to a WBC world title. And I think we have a film that we're going to show that she sent us.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to the 2020 Hall of Fame. Unfortunately, due to unforeseen circumstances, I won't be able to attend today. I want to thank all the volunteers and Ed for putting together this amazing event, the biggest Hall of Fame ever, 3 years of inductees. I want to congratulate all of you with your honor of being a great champion, of being a recognized champion today. I'm very grateful that I was part of being a great champion in the era that we all lost. I know most of you personally. I'm honored to have worked with you, fought with you on same cards, or even was scheduled on cards to fight some of you with my students, but also as a fighter. Thank you for your great work. I hope this message reaches all of you in great health. And I'm wearing my American flag because I miss America. I've been in the Netherlands now for 2 years. I hope to be able to come home soon and receive my ring, just like all of you. I'm grateful to have beautified my whole life. I built my new career of all the knowledge I gained as a combat artist and a champion, even outside the ring. I want to thank my trainers, Freddie Roach and Amanda Stewart. I want to thank all my managers, assistant trainers, promoters, and also the fighters that gave me the opportunity to fight on the other card, or like James Toney, to be able to go to training camp with you. And I salute you, and I respect all of you greatly. Thank you.
Okay, next, a native of New Orleans, he was introduced to the sport by his prize fighter father and began a sports writing career as a copy boy in the New Orleans Times, Picayune, and later at the Miami Herald and Jackson Daily News in Mississippi. A few bouts he covered from ringside are Ali and Spinks II, Mike Tyson, Michael Spinks, Buster Douglas and Tyson, Mickey Ward and the Gotti series, and Julio Cesar Chavez and Taylor. He now writes for such bouts as The Ring and The Sweet Science, received over 100 awards for writing and public service. A five-term president of the Boxing Writers Association, has appeared in three boxing films. The 2020 Observer Hall of Famer is Bernard Fernandez, and coming up to accept the Bernard is his friend Joe, which is my last name, on Santa Winkler. Thank you.
to meet my hero. You know, just out of school, loved boxing, loved everything around me. And here I am, and the man appears, my hero. And sweaty Freddie Flintstone. Just got out of playing basketball. We used to have special league events last year. And Bertie was on a mission to find cheese goldfish. He was hungry. He says, I haven't eaten anything. I'm this young, younger kid. I come up, I'm like, ah, Joe, I gotta get some meat. So Bertie pulled up and by me. And if anybody ever saw Bertie at Titan, it's crazy. There was cheese fish and branch dip flying everywhere. So I knew better to stay away. And eventually Bernie came over, introduced himself to me, and it blossomed into a beautiful friendship, I could say. He and his wife Danny were my second parents to me. It was Bernie that saved the BWA for extension. It was Bernie that was great that he loved as a child. In the homes of the great city of Philadelphia. Like no one. I want to be able to walk when I'm 74. Bernie's still writing about. He has a few books out now, anthologies from his amazing work, those have been seen about fame. And Bernie, we want to congratulate all the non-Mulligan inductees. He's humbled and honored by his great achievement. And if it wasn't, it's been a difficult situation for him. He had to do what was right. Being right is with his work. Anne's going through this. She's doing this right now, so they need to know. And he wasn't about to leave her side when every second is precious. He thanks Anne and Jeff Brophy. And he wants to start to thank his children, Kevin, Randy, Melanie, and Amy, for his support and always being there. Mostly he wants to thank Anne, because without her, he's not here. Bernie didn't need a million admirers, just one. He got to cover support he loved as a child, and he did well for decades. He did a great job for the Rocky Town News. He got to cover now one of the greatest fighters of all time, one of boxing's greatest ambassadors. He's become a friend of the Rockies. So I'm going to do something.
Correlated with Showtime to facilitate the Super Six
World Boxing Classic Super Middleweight Tournament. In 2016, he promoted the first heavyweight title bout in Brooklyn in 115 years. For his passion for the sport and his boxers, 2020 Hall of Fame inductee will not participate in the category, Lou DeBella.
Lou! Lou!
On a Friday to offer me a job on a Monday, and that changed my life.
And then just one note on Seth Abraham, at a period of time where boxing was in crisis, where there had been a huge scandal with Boston Network TV, boxing didn't have a home. Seth embraced, HBO embraced boxing, and the rest of his history, boxing had a run in the 80s and 90s, like no other, at HBO had 50 years as the industry leader of boxing. And thank you, Seth, you belong in the Hall of Fame. My beloved entertainment family, everybody that's worked for me since I left HBO, I want to shout out a few of them, Meredith, Alice, and Sean, who are like my ride or dies. And everybody that's ever worked for me at DVE, so many of them are still friends and family to me, and I thank you all. I want to thank my family, and I want to thank my mom, who's 88 years old. I wish she was here today. I want to thank my mom. She's a wacky, wild, creative, brilliant, nutty person that probably sounds familiar to some of you. And she made me believe that there was nothing that her little boy couldn't do. And I wouldn't be here without her. My dad, who's not here any longer, who was my hero, my dad gave me two of the greatest lessons I ever had. First one, if you want to be respected, earn it. Because nothing comes for free. And if you want to be respected, you need to respect people, you need to listen to people, you need to treat them correctly. And the second message is you can have all the money in the world. You can have the greatest house for $100,000 luxury or a Bentley, and if you've lost your humanity, you have enough. The rest of my dad would say more succinctly, it all doesn't matter if you're a piece of shit. my partner in crime, Jeff Giannone, thank you for loving me and putting up with this crazy business. I think I've been up here fellows and just looking at others when you're involved in the boxing world in the 80s. So I want to thank her. Most importantly,
beyond that, I've often said that some of the best people I've met in my life are in boxing, and many of the worst people I've met in my life are in boxing. But it's never boring, and it's a great writer's sport. Let me start from the fighters. Your sport. The rest of us are just along for the ride. I'm indebted to every fighter who allowed me into this dressing room in the hours before he fought, so I could chronicle that night for history. And I'm equally indebted to all the other fighters for being who you are. I'd like to acknowledge the promoters, trainers, managers, matchmakers, ring doctors, television executives, announcers, fellow writers, and all the others in the boxing community who have been so generous in sharing their knowledge with me. I'm very moved by the thought of each and every person who put a check next to my name on the Hall of Fame induction ballot. Voting is anonymous, so I don't know who you are. Thank you. A special thank you to Muhammad Ali. And thank you to the fans, those of you who are gathered here today and beyond. One of the nicest things about writing for a living is the realization that on occasion someone actually reads what I write. A lot of the motivation for what I do comes from you. Mike Jones, who managed Billy Costello to a world title, was my first guide through boxing. 4 decades ago, Mike said something that has always stayed with me. And in closing, I'd like to share it with you now. To understand boxing, you have to understand tradition and what it takes to get inside a ring. You have to learn about promoters and television and what goes on inside a fighter's head from the time his career begins until the day it ends. You have to grasp the reality of smashed faces and pain and understand how they can be part of something courageous and exciting and beautiful. I know, I've been there. And after everything I've been through in boxing, I can look you square in the eye and tell you boxing is beautiful, the purest sport in the world. You cannot promote it, you cannot train it. Managers, even fighters, but don't knock boxing. It's the best sport there is, and anyone who's ever been involved will tell you it's an honor to be associated with boxing. Thank you.
She earned a BA in English from Montclair State and began a career as a reporter and editor at the Wayne Today newspapers and the New York Daily News. She was introduced to the sweet science by her husband Dan and began as director of public relations for the family-run Made Events in 1977. Following Dan's passing in 1996, she assumed the role of CEO and she orchestrated the return of boxing to the network television with the NBC Boxing Series and Fighter Night on NBC. An honors graduate from Seton Hall Law School, she is one of the most respected promoters of boxing, the non-participant category 2020 Hall of Fame inductee, Kathy Duva.
Installed next to mine at some point in the coming weeks, so I'll wear it on. He was the smartest, the best, the most honorable person that I've ever known. To be included alongside him here forever is the best part of what's happening to me today. Dan and I worked together with some all-time great writers. In fact, if you know them already, they're all men in Holyfield, Colonel Whitaker, Lennox Lewis, Arturo Gatti. And many men have played a small part in events involving the number of the incredible fighters that are being inducted today. But in love, a few more of the fighters will run out here someday. I know that I never imagined that a thing like this could ever happen to me. I'm doubly sure that Dan never imagined either, but neither of us would have made it here or had the lives we had if it wasn't for the talent, the dedication, the discipline, the effort of so many great, great fighters. They all acknowledge, as both male and female, I would say, who make boxing so special. They are the best conditioned, hardest working, most dedicated athletes any sport in the world, and they all deserve all of our love and recognition today. So for the rest of today's audience, because I know most of you pretty well, but I know how hard you worked to get here. I want to thank Ed Brophy, Sister Grace, all the members of the hall, the staff, the incredible volunteers that are here. If you're not up in this group, you don't understand how every time you turn around, there's a little elf around ready to help you out and get you exactly where you need to be, and I know how hard they work because I do logistics for a living, and I appreciate the amazing undertaking that they have accomplished here. I also want to shout out to the members of my staff, past and present, Joel Tumba, Alexis Sullivan, Don Shea, and Keenan. And of course, the incomparable Jolene Rizal, who take a page from Britney's book, she'll be ending up here someday. I want to thank my dear friends who have made the trek up here and some very special members of my family who are also in attendance. You know, a few years ago, through the magic of DNA, my daughter managed to find both of my birth families. And so this weekend, this adopted only child is joined by two brothers, my sister, two nieces, cousins or spouses. We've got a great nephew here and a great niece here the other day. And I want to thank all of you for accepting to your families and for being here today. Like everyone in this room, I've lost far too many dear people along the way. And so I reflect on all of them today as well. The people who should have been here too. And there's a lot of them. The presence of so many very special people who are here today, my family, my friends, all of the boxing people who are like a family, wherever you go, they've made this immeasurable honor that is being bestowed on me by this hall. The most amazing thing I think that's ever happened to me. Before I finish, the last and most important thank you I have to give to my beautiful children, Nicole, Lisa, and Ryan. I know you didn't have it easy. You lost your dad young. You had me bouncing around all over the world doing what I wasn't to do. Taking calls in the middle of the night and just trying to split my attention between the far more important goings on in your life. And I appreciate the fact that you were always behind me, as my son says, he toughened me up for this business. I think that's true. The girls did too. We got to
reading about Polly Burns, who boxed in the early 1900s.
At 18, she began training at London's Wayfair Gym and boxed exhibitions and fairs. She ventured to the United States in 1952. She boxed throughout North America and only lost one contest to Joanne Hagen, who outweighed her by 30 pounds. She won the bantamweight title of the world with a unanimous decision over Philadelphia's Kobler in 1957. During her groundbreaking career, she boxed over 100 exhibitions against both men and women and posted a pro record of 30 wins, 1 loss, and 1 draw. In 1993, she started the Women's International Boxing Federation. In the Trailblazer category, 2020, Hall of Fame inductee Barbara Buttrick.
Daughter after her father's business, she remains in the sport as CEO of Crystal.
time me while I do this. It's not my way to do it. First of all, I want to thank the Hall of Fame and all the volunteers, Ed Brophy, the whole world, everybody, for all the work that it takes from year to year to year to get this done, especially this year with building. Thank all the fans. Some of these fighters up here, of course, were much better fighters. Most were much better speakers, or are much better speakers. But none of them love their job more than I do. But I want to share a quick story. 1996, after I fought Dieter Gogarty, I was invited to be the Grand Marshal for the induction for that year Hall of Fame. The PR guy called me, I told him no, absolutely not, I will not go. I was too scared. I mean, these guys are legends. We're talking about Willie Peck, Carmen Basilio, Gene Fulmer, I mean, the list goes on and on. Archie Moore. Finally, they told me, you can't say no, you have to go through that. You have to go through this. So I did, and fortunate for me, those guys that I just mentioned, they kind of put their arms around me, the older guys, and took me in as a granddaughter, and told me they appreciated my hard work, and my method was pretty good. When I was doing my speech that year, I turned and looked at all the guys, and I remember Marvin Hagler being one of them, and Aaron Pryor, and I said, you know, all these boxing brothers up here, someday you're gonna need a sister. Guess what? It's your sister. I'm just very honored to be that sister to all these legends. And I'm not gonna take up all your time. I'm not gonna take up any more time. So I talked to you for 2 minutes, almost 2 minutes. In that 2 minutes, 40 people in this country were abused in a domestic violence situation. 40 people, just while I talked to you. Have a great day. Thank you for everything you've done. Thank you. Thank you.
California,
he
amassed over 200 amateur wins before turning pro in 1993.
Sugar Sam!
In 1997,
defeated Philip Holliday for the IBM Lightweight Championship in a string of 8 successful defense.
Sugar Shane!
In 2000, he defeated Oscar De La Hoya for the WBC Welterweight title.
Oh, yes, Sugar Shane.
During his career, he was widely considered the top four-round fighter and electrified fight fans with a dazzling combination of speed and power in the modern category. 2020 Hall of Fame inductee, Sugar Shane.
Sugar
yesterday, the last one.
battles close, three battles. Legendary referee, three battles. Is he close? Is he? He's here, right? Can somebody put a good battle for a minute to be important? Okay. And my son, Bernard Hopkins III, where you at? Where you at, son? Let's come. Let's go. Let's go.
Let's get the
time. And they let me go. My statistics got straight back in the penitentiary, but still got it. It was 9, I got 7 years to walk off now. 88, 89, maybe 90 now. If you look at my record, I challenge everyone when they leave. In 88, I lost the penitentiary, I said it yesterday. 89, I went active. 90, we was up knowing and what was happening in that year and a half before I rebooted and met Rick Stewart's dude. Pretty bad. We lived. I'm long enough to give me his word that it would make the connection. Rudy, great Hall of Fame.
Line up here, we're going to take a short picture. I'm going to do this with each class.
Okay, we're going to be ready for the class of 2021, I should say. We're going to have a video to start that off first.
Thank you.
Hopefully he's still with us, y'all.
134 victories, 6 losses, with 65 KOs in his amateur career. By winning a super heavyweight gold in the 1996 Olympic Games, turned pro in Germany and tallied 24 straight victories before losing to Ross Perry. He rebounded with Axel Schultz and Monty Barrett, among others, before defeating Chris Bird for the WBO heavyweight title. After 5 successful defenses following before being upset by Corey Sanders. After the loss, he enlisted Emanuel Stewart as his trainer. After an up-and-down start, he stopped Bird for the IBF IBO titles and began to dominate a 9-year title reign that included 18 successful defenses. Combining athleticism, dominant jab, and punishing power to register a 76.8 knockout number. And that's 2021 minor category, Vladimir Klitschko. I mean, we don't have a lot of people, but we do have a video.
Keep on punching and choose me.
UCLA and MD from Chicago Medical School before completing an internal medicine internship and residency in neurology from 1993 to 1996 to perform neurological evaluations for boxers and regulations of the Nevada State Athletic Commission. From 1994 to 2005, she was a ring physician in the Nevada and worked over 500 boxing and mixed martial arts contests. She was instrumental in establishing MRI tests for fighters and is the chair of the Voluntary Anti-Doping Association. Doctor received the Boxing Writers James Farley Award for Honesty and Integrity in Boxing. 2001 Hall of Fame inductee, the non-participant category, Dr. Margaret Goodman. Competition in the few states that permitted female boxing. following a drawn-out legal battle that included suits by other women, in September of 1978, she, along with Jackie Tanawino and Cat Davis, were among the first women granted licenses in the Empire State. In 1979, she defeated Sue K.O. Carlson for the Women's World Lightweight title, tireless advocate for women in the sport. Marion Lady Tiger Trimier, 2021, placed the category.
Lights.
Check. Here we go. He is an advocate and true supporter of women boxing. He was a big comfort to me when my mother passed away. Chris was one of my best friends. Attorney Cecilia Gurriel, the name of Ms. Ward, she's a good friend and a good person. And she's a lawyer. Attorney Cecilia. Attorney Gloria Orman, Sophia Sabor, Alan Snowwell, Joanna Cho, Regina Thomas, Christine Martin, Bonnie Nan, Leo Ollie, Ann Lowe, Sonner, Dee, Mike Stewart, he's one of the guys that helped me train for a lot of my class. Tyrone Jackson, Eddie Montalvo, he has a beautiful family, and he can tell you all about my story in Spanish Harbor. Brenda Zalazoga, Randy Gordon, who's a boxing commissioner, Georgina Camilleri, Cassie Thornton, Siri Brooke, Mary Hill, Steve Johnson, Yvonne Springsteen Scott, Killer Diana, Cheryl Trainer, Rick Van Busker, Anna Gordon, Paul Driscoll, Sandra Green, and Carmen, who is holding this right now, has been my home attendant, home out aide, for more than 7 years. She's married with two children, and her boyfriend, I mean, this one, I must have but anyway, Carmen has been my home health aide. She is always on time. She does my hair and makeup. She cooks, cleans. She's a secretary and a nurse. I taught her English, and she taught me Spanish. But hola, mi amiga. I just meal.
Congratulations. spent about 3 days with everyone on the stage, chopping it up with them. For the first time in my life, I feel like I'm leaving. They treated me with respect, they treated me as if they were one of their peers. It's been a long time coming. God has formed me. He's given me everything I've ever wanted. At this point in time, there's only one thing I want to ask of Him, and that's for Him to keep me in His perfect peace, because He's given me everything else. Jennifer, Latanya, Zion, we did it, baby. I'm gonna walk my baby to the world.
Over Alan Reed, Psycho Pika, and Arthur Abraham. before defeating Carol Roach, in the finals of the WBC title. He set his sights on the 175-pound division and defeated Sergey Koloff for the WBA, IBF, WBO titles. He retired with a record of 34-32 wins, no losses, and 16 KOs. Renowned for his impeccable skills and ring intuition, he remains active in the sport as a ringside commentator. 2021 category, Hall of Fame inductee Andre Ward.
I want to thank Ed Rogan and his team. They do a great job. First
got them Golden State colors on.
And just amazing how a small town feels like a big town because everybody rides together. So I appreciate you team, you got to do a great job. And keeping me cool because I was calling you like Lily was calling me, like, where are we getting in? I know it's cold, and I know we got mad, and I need my ring in front of you. I appreciate you. I want to thank God, not just for being here, but just keeping me, you know, in life. Started off good, then I went astray, and, you know, I almost lost it all at one point in time in my life, and he pulled me out of that, and he sustained me in a business like boxing. Boxing can be an amazing sport, but it's a cold, treacherous place sometimes, inside the ring and outside the ring. And I'm still here, I'm allowed to talk about it, so I thank God for that. I want to thank my wife. You know, I gave her some flowers yesterday, but I want to thank her again just for riding with me. You know, she struggled with me. She went through everything with me, and she grinded with me. So now we're shining together. I love you. I appreciate you. And I couldn't be here without you. I want to thank my four beautiful children, Andre Jr., Malachi, Mira, my five children. I forgot one. Amari and Champ, you know, I did this for y'all. You know, it's a lot of early mornings in boxing. Remember everybody's sleeping. It's a lot of late nights in the gym. And there's a lot of times we don't want to go to training camp and get ready. But I had y'all in mind. You know, I didn't want to look at your faces if something went bad in your room. I used to think about that Sunday morning looking at y'all after a fight, if I lost. And I didn't want to do that. And I appreciate you guys just sticking with your daddy. I missed some things, but you know, we're not complaining now. You made it to the home, and they can't take that away from us. So I appreciate you guys. Lily and Bernie, I thank you guys, my godparents, for taking me and my brother in. We didn't have nowhere to go. And Virg, I thank you for guiding me in life and in the sport of boxing, and teach me the right way to fight. Hit and not get hit. And that's what I'm here to talk about right now. I appreciate you teaching me the art of boxing. I want to thank my mother, Madam. You know, we've been through some hard times, but I thank God for you because you got a lot of fight in you. And I got a lot of fight for you. And you never stop trying to be in my life. You never stop trying to bring my family back together for that. I'm thankful, I'm grateful, and I appreciate you and I love you. To my mother-in-law, Amir, thank you for letting this little Bradley Bates boy who came from Oakland and was trying to date your daughter. Thank you for giving me an opportunity. I know you weren't feeling me at first. You was looking at me kind of sideways. And you didn't believe I was going to be a gold medalist, but I told you I was going to win that gold medal. Treating your baby girl the right way. So I appreciate the opportunity to dance her and be with her. I thank my dad. You know, my dad's been dead 20 years now. He gave me the foundation of my faith in God. And, you know, he started me out of this sport. He died right before he even took off. But his life has been speaking through me the last 20 years. So, Dad, I know you'll be happy and proud. This one's for you. I love you and I thank you for everything that you gave me. I didn't get here by myself. You know, I want to make sure I pay homage to the ones that deserve it. My pastors back in the Bay Area, Pastor Nicole, Pastor Napoleon, keep praying, keep on your side of this people.
Yes!
prayed for me, covered me, looked out for me. I love y'all, and I appreciate y'all so much. Jay Prince, when Jay found me, I was double boxing. I was in the streets. I still don't know how he found me. He found me. Got my number somehow and tracked me down. I remember him telling me, I told him all my problems, everything I was doing with him, and he said, we're gonna take care of all our missing media problems. We just need to get you back in the room. And Verge told Jay, he asked him, you help me with this kid, help me get him back on track. He's gonna win and go again. He kept my word to you, Jay, and you kept your word to us. So I love you, man, and I appreciate you. To Josh Newman, bro, I appreciate you for fighting for me, man. Never let nobody take advantage of me with these contracts. We learn together, we grew together, and I appreciate you for always encouraging me to be more than just a fighter. And let me know that boxing was a piece of my life, it wasn't my whole life. So I appreciate you, Lord, and I love you. My boy Jack, man, Jack is probably one of the most underrated trainers, strength and conditioning, and boxing coaches in the game. Edward Jackson, bro, I appreciate you for putting up with me in training camp. I appreciate you for being patient when I've been yelling at you, because I come in my locker room and they got the AC on, and I'm trying to warm up, and I say, man, tell them to turn the air off, and if you come back and the air's still on, and you're trying to explain it, and they're working on it, and I'm getting on you, I appreciate you, bro. And I appreciate the ride, man, we made it. And to my brother Antonio Henry, man, I appreciate you, bro, because, you know, boxing was a tough business, but I knew when it was fight time, because T would show up. T always kept everybody loose, and he never stopped telling me, you're the best, champ. You're the best. And I appreciate you, bro. And the rest of my family and friends, you know who you are. I appreciate you for the role you played in my life. And I couldn't be here without you. And I got to thank my big three, man. I don't understand. It don't make sense to me. And I told others yesterday. My big three, Roy Jones, Bernard Hopkins, Floyd Mayweather. Roy, I appreciate you, man, because you was a country boy with swag. You had to feel like this country boy was a place to be. I want to tell you, man. I want to dance in the rain like you dance, do a rooster dance. And you was the first one that I heard talk about the business of boxing. And why you started Square Ring Promotions with Brad Jacobs, and why you did it. And you talk about fighter safety and fighters being taken advantage of. I never forgot that, bro. I appreciate that. And to Bernard Hopkins, the least likely to succeed with your background and where you came from.
Yes.
But you overachieved. And the lesson you taught me was discipline. I remember the story of Bernard yelling at Nazim Richardson or anybody that came in the gym with a soda pop. Man, we can't have that stuff in here, man. That's poison. Man, get that stuff out of the gym. Man, I'm trying to be a champion until I retire. And I'll be looking at him like, he did what? He said what? But that's the kind of discipline that you had to have if you was going to be sitting in this seat today. Okay. Use an example, bro, and I appreciate it. And to Floyd Mayweather. Again, boxing was a treacherous business. It's hard. But Floyd always made boxing look fun. And I appreciate that. I appreciate how you dealt with your big moments, bro. I know you had a lot of pressure on you. You put some of it on yourself because you told me what you were going to do. And you had swag with it, and you didn't bite your tongue. So that brought more pressure. But the whole world, I don't say the whole world, a lot of people wanted to see you get beat. Because everybody says they love a winner, but that's not true. When you win a long time, I want to see you get beat just to see what's going to happen. I appreciate your dedication to the game, bro. Woo-hoo! I got four of these two in El Elador. One video after the next, I watched it. I picked up every little thing, and I imitated it, made it my own, put my own flavor in it. I'm almost done. I feel like Floyd yesterday. I feel like Floyd yesterday. You know, I get people that ask me all the time, you know, who was the hardest puncher that I fought, and who was my toughest fighter? And I always tell them in the box. Throughout my career, you know, I fought a lot of great champions and had a lot of great fights. But I was always fighting the sport at the same time. You know, the narratives or the stereotypes that didn't fit, the prejudices and the biases that we face, I was trying to fight those too. And the idea that people would try to tell me that I couldn't be a man of God or be a believer or a man of faith in a sport like boxing. I've had people tell me that nobody wants to hear that, bro. Well, my response was, Lord, you can go in here and talk about this and talk about that. I can talk about who gave you the power to do what I did. I don't care. I be humble about it. I'm not trying to be obnoxious about my faith. If you ask me, how did I do something? You got to tell me.
Amen.
Glory to God. And, you know, through this sport, I've taken my lungs, and I'm not saying in the ring, I'm saying in some of these fights that I fought, you know, and I got out there a few times in the business of boxing, you know, and I got my scars to prove it. And because boxing is a formidable opponent, but I continue to fight on it, and I refuse to fall victim to the old demons and the things that try to take fighters out and rob fighters of their money, their legacy, and their faculty. The biggest fight that I had with boxing was when was the time to walk away and how was I going to go out? I've been retired now for 5 years, and almost every day the sport is trying to pull me back. But every day that I stay going to sport is another day that I win. And if I stick to my word and stay on and never come back and leave my legacy the way that it is, I ensure that boxing never defeats me. I want to leave that blueprint for the young life, the young fighters that's coming behind us. I'm going to say this in closing, y'all. I know you don't like to talk this much, but I got to do this today. Every fighter on this stage right here, even the fighters in the room, future Hall of Famers, champions, you know, we deal with extreme criticism and a lot of praise. And I had to learn this lesson the hard way. I had to learn to live my life in the middle. And I'm still learning that lesson. You know, some people love you, some people don't. Some people will respect and acknowledge what you've learned in the sport, some people won't. But one thing I do know is when you make it here to Canastota, New York, and you sit on the stage with great champions like this, male and female, at this point, the debate is over. Thank you very much. lights off the right way. I've done a lot in my career, but this is by far the best. Yesterday, we shared tears, tears of joy. That's part of the fight game. Let's fight the tears. But today, I took a few key notes that I took down in my notes that I want to talk about. You know, yesterday I talked about everybody about love, everybody about life, I'm talking about all these great fighters up here. But today, I want to talk about me. Talk about TDE, hard work. Hard work. Okay, so y'all with me. All work is what? We're pointing to the easy work then. I must always give thanks to the man above. Always. Because without God, all this would be possible. I'm glad that we were able to make it here safe, sound fluid. Thank you for making it here safe. Thank you for supporting the sport of boxing. Thank you for supporting all these great, legendary champions. My dad is a genius. My dad is a great man. He's a man with integrity. He's a stand-up guy. And I will always put him first. And to the queen, my mother, a great woman, ambitious. She has the will to win in life. So when you take my dad, who's the best trainer ever, and you take my mother, another queen, so you take that king and that queen and you put them together, this is what you do.
Yeah!
You are, man. I look good, I fight good, I'm undefeated, I've dominated the sport for 20 years straight. Unbelievable to be able to work with players in position to take care of their families is remarkable. That's what it's about. See, it's not about what you make. It's what you, I make a lot of money. But guess what? It's what you do with the money. I'm able to put my sister in a position to be an entrepreneur. Put people on my team in a position to be an entrepreneur. That's what it's about. I teach you how to fish. I can't fish for you. Al, I want to personally say thank you for us coming together and changing the sport of boxing. I got in the sport. I put the heavyweights out of business. This is what I did. I brought the real money to the small guys. Boy, they would have did that. Leonard Ellerby, my ride or die.
Now we want to talk about why I'm TV. I'm telling you.
biggest pay-per-views of all time. And I got six. They had me in a contract that I didn't want to be in. So I said, you know what? I'll buy myself out my contract for $750,000. And when I left you guys, I made $750 million just to be promised. Woo! I never let the sport of boxing fall over me.
Pay money?
They said, well, who got the biggest cake? Well, I said, well, I got a 75 million in 10 minutes with the Mayweather Pacquiao. So, you know, I hold that record too. And we all know I'm the highest grossing fighter ever. I'm the highest grossing fighter ever. Yeah, I'm gonna pop my shit. I can see it too.
Yeah, Mike Tyson. Maybe his hair. Yeah.
It's a bunch of guys.
Okay, folks, we're going to go on to the 2022 class. First, we're going to do, again, a little film to start it off.
Germany, please welcome Regina Hall!
go, go, go!
Up here today.
They all kindly shared their time and stories with me. They helped me understand how they did this most extraordinary act of facing the pain and loneliness of the boxing ring, when most of us could only sit outside and dream. What I learned from them all is that boxing is about controlling your opponent, but more importantly, it's about controlling yourself, which is the most difficult thing to do in life. It's about getting up when you're down and realizing it's not so much how hard you hit that's important, but rather how hard you get hit and keep moving forward. Through all these years watching all these fighters, I never felt a worse day in my life. My dad worked in construction all his life, and he used to say to me, "When you go to work, you just go to games. But boxing's no game." But I'd like to thank a few people who helped me get here. First, my wife, Nina, who's always been the one person in my corner with sound advice and an end swell when I needed it. And my children, Laura and Jack, who are my reason to keep on working. Thank you, three, for letting me into my dream. Thanks to the voters who put me here today, and Ed Brophy and his great staff, and the volunteers at the hall, for making me feel so welcome what I considered hallowed ground. I know this would never happen without the readers and viewers who took the time to listen to what I had to say about this most confounding but thrilling sport. And thanks, of course, to all the fighters who gave me the opportunity to tell their stories. Without their graciousness and patience, my incessant questions, as well as their supreme courage and skill inside the ring, I would not be here today. It was a pleasure for me to go to work every day. I'm sure it always wasn't a pleasure for some of these guys up here to read or hear what I had to say, but I always tried to call it the way I saw it. And even when we disagreed, I never had anything but respect for the men and women who chose to express themselves in the most dangerous trade of yours. That was from the first time I walked into a steamy, dank old gym in Sacramento, California, looking for an old fight guy with a cigar named Sid Tenney, only to learn he wasn't there. He told me, "Nah, he's over in Mitch George's card room doing business. He'll be the guy next to the baseball." I knew right then, boxing was the sport for me. It was love at first sight, and all these years later, despite its many blemishes and harshness at times, I love it still. So although I'm not the lead singer of the class of 22, and they are proud just to be part of the band. Thanks.
Greatest fans in the world,
assure you that you will stand with me. That's scary. That's scary. Your children are there. As they look around and see people who are marvel that they come. And these, admire their business acumen and enjoy their writing talents. Some of them are able to look at us and be able to call Fred. And I'm honored beyond belief to be able to share this day with them. So I'd like to thank the Hall of Fame, all the voting members, for this unbelievable honor. This is not about me. This is about the opportunity to say it, though, to you as possible. First and foremost, it's about my family. I wish my mother and father were still alive to be here, but hopefully you've seen this in my eye. When some small way paid the back for some of the sacrifices they made for me, helping email Thomas envelope, putting up all the phone calls, bugging you while they were on vacation, finding information from me in the local newspapers, doing a million other things that bothered me. I have the best parents in the world, that can never be here. I also have been blessed with this amazing, wonderful family. A loving, supportive wife who, by the way, just you can get what I'm all about. One of our first dates, she came to the library, to the library. She finally left us as Robin's name, which is like a microphone. So, to the two daughters, as I tell them, I love them to the stars of the young, Libby, Chelsea, Courtney, Mark, Kevin, you're the best. This is about those who gave me the encouragement to drive when I was first getting into boxing. People like Malcolm Flash Gordon, Jack Obermeyer, Hank Cap, Harold Letterman, Johnny Boz, and those others. It's about those record keepers in the story who worked tirelessly to keep the glorious past of our sport alive. Eric Garman, Joe Koizumi, Victor Cota, Julio Vila, Giuseppe Balrad, Herb Goldman, Ralph Sitcho, and about the other minorities, all the members of Ebro, too many more to name. There are also a few who'd really like to give a special thanks to what they've done for me. Bruce Trampler, who's also in the Hall of Fame, is a Hall of Fame matchmaker and a Hall of Fame friend who gave me my first real opportunities. He was at Madison Square Garden. Alex Wallow gave me my start at ABC, which I was still like to do some bigger things. I want to take this opportunity to make a little pitch for Alex. You know, not only was he an outstanding analyst, you remember him on ABC, but people forget the other things that he did while at ABC. The analysis he started in Fox, the Lampley, Al Michaels, and others, the events which he produced and oversaw, perhaps something which, got its own merits, should put him in the Hall. I want you to think about where boxing might be if Alex had not uncovered a scandal in the 70s when Don King and ABC got together for that infamous tournament. Alex is part of dismantling that and changing the landscape. You know, boxing for many years to come. And Jose Mauricio Suleiman. People say that the only way to affect change is from within. And Jose and his son Mauricio gave me that opportunity with the various positions I had held in the World Boxing Council. You know, very few others love the sport and love boxers with the passion of Suleiman. They are more family. Thank the fans, because it is your love of the sport that keep the athletes who are willing to sacrifice it all after ready. But most of all, we like to thank the boxers, the greats, the near greats, and even the normal ones. For without the boxers, there is no boxing. Without their blood, their sweat, yes, their tears, our great sport is not theirs. Without their hard work and all our sacrifices, there would be nothing to cheer for, no skills from our blood, no raw emotional feel that we all watch the best in action. That's why we never ever move any fighter who's willing to putting in earnest effort in the ring. They have agreed with me and afforded to enter a boxing ring, and they have earned my respect and my to my admiration, regardless of the outcome. I cannot even lie behind the camera, not in front of me. I've loved boxing for over 50 years, and I know and I'm sure I'll love it for the rest of my days. Thank you again for this incredible honor.
Enthralled with boxing from a young age. He began his career in boxing in 1970. 1962, when he was hired to handle public relations for promoter Bill Mitzkoff and Hall of Famer Joe Rice. He was the first publicist hired by
the right up. For his 62, stand up.
At King Productions. His expertise was in high demand, consulting positions in every major promoter over the last 4+ decades, including Bob Arum, Lee Eaton, George Parnassus, Danny Wilson, Don Kelly, and Oscar. He's been awarded by the Maxim Raiders twice, first in 2010 with the Marvin Coleman Goodwin Award, and 2016 with the Barnett Neighbor Award for the Law and Material Service to Maxim. 2022, non-participant category is Bill Kaepernick. Germany, a former standout amateur kickboxer, she began boxing in 1994. With technical precision and aggressive style, she would catch world titles in three weight divisions. She defended her title 28 times. A hero in Germany, she retired in 2007 with a professional record of 54 victories, one loss, one draw, and 16 knockouts. A dangerous lady, 2022 Hall of Fame inductee in the modern category, Regina Hummel.
Thank you.
your job.
You know, I didn't start walking when I was really young. I grew up with a family that, you know, was from a boxing background. When I did find boxing, and it was my passion, I had the support. And I've had the support my whole life, no matter what it was, from my parents. My father and my mother always encouraging me to follow my dreams. I'm so thankful that I've had that love and support my whole life, that they wanted me to fulfill whatever I had and make me truly believe that I can accomplish these things. It's not about anything that I put my heart to. And to my brothers who always have my biggest fans, I could be anybody in their book.
Alright, we on it. We got a.
I'm Jerry Tony.
Y'all must have got this for going on. Scales and dogs will flip through the door.
Okay, folks, we have completed our trilogy. How about the number? Thank you.